I'm still tired. I will forever be tired. I will be tired for all eternity. It never ends.
Hey, thanks for joining the Escape With Me Book Club. Escape with me, Lizzie Sawyer.
And me, Sam Reiner.
Into our most recent read. Come with us as we evade reality, go into detail about a new book. We'll be covering it from beginning to end, so remember, there will be spoilers.
Today we are going to Victorian era London. Published in 2009, A Spy in the House is an imagining of the world from the mind of someone with a PhD in Victorian literature and culture. With the ease of an expert, Y.S. Lee takes readers to a residence near the Thames that drips with authenticity as well as intrigue and romance. Something is going on in this house, and Mary has been sent there to figure out what it is. This was a you pick.
Yes, it was a me pick, because it's a good book. This is another one that was suggested to me by my mother because she had read it first and gave it to me because she knows the genre that I enjoy reading.
I should honestly just start asking you to give your mom's background. How did she find this story?
Well, she was on Goodreads and one of the things suggested it to her and she was like, oh, that looks good. I'll read that. That's how she gets most of her books.
Goodreads actually doing some good in this world. Yay.
Yep. She's also in a lot of groups. And so every now and again, someone will be like, this book. And she'll be like, whoa, dope. My mom will never, ever say, whoa, dope. And because I did an audiobook, I didn't really have a what I thought the book was going to be about thing because mom was like, the book's about this. And I was like, oh, okay, cool. Yeah, it sounds like something I would read. And I read it.
That kind of happened because you were like, hey, this is about XYZ. But I immediately equated it to be closer to I tell you I'd love you, but then I'd have to kill you, which is a book that also is a mystery romance, sort of, and in the same genre. So I don't know which one came first, actually. Not that it really, really matters, but I tell you I love you and then I have to kill you. It takes place, she's still in school, and the book is about her training, and so that's really cool. So I was expecting it a bit to be more about her training. I wasn't expecting it to be like, hey, join the agency. Now go on missions.
Yep.
Away with you. So that was a fun surprise. The title of the book is on point.
Yeah, it is.
There was a spy in the house.
Technically, there was two, even though we don't meet the other one.
Well, she wasn't in the house. She was in the, I want to say factory, but it's not a factory. Warehouse?
They never actually say where she's located.
Yeah.
They just say that she's on the case.
So she's not in the house. She's on the case. It's different.
It doesn't mean she's not in the house. She could also be in the house.
Well, what's the point of sending Mary there if you've already got someone in the house?
I don't know. I'm just saying that she could also be in the house because it never says she isn't.
I still think she's not because her main focus is the warehouse anyway. I've always wondered if maybe she dresses up like a boy or something. I don't know, to get access. I was curious about how she got access and stuff.
I mean, they'll hire women to make tea for the offices.
That's true. We only ever see it at night. Which, 100%, that black dog is a Doberman. As soon as she goes to that warehouse and describes the dog, I'm like, that's a Doberman. Straight up, that's a Doberman. He's big, he's black, he's floppy-eared, he's good. He's a good, friendly dog that guards your things, but also want treats. Does the dog come up again?
Yeah, at the end of the book.
No, I meant in the other books.
No.
Aw.
And if it does, it's very briefly at the beginning, which is why I don't remember it.
Yeah, because at the end of this book, she's like, hey, can I keep the dog? And they're like, we'll see to it or something like that. And they didn't commit to a yes, you can keep it, but they didn't necessarily say no. So I was curious if we would see it again.
Well, she also didn't say, can I keep it? She was just kind of like, how do you feel about dogs? And they were like, dogs?
There was this dog. It was very cute. I would like to see that it is kept. I would like to keep it. And they were like, we'll see it with the dog. And that never got resolved. But I guess that would be kind of cumbersome to just suddenly take a position and have a Doberman with you. Like, that would give you some looks. Or at least that would give her some looks. But this is a pretty cool, I don't know whether to put it in mystery or romance, because it's both. And there were seriously parts where it would turn straight into a romance novel, and I let my guard down, and all of a sudden, holy crap, we're back to mystery. Hello. Everything got really, really intense all of a sudden.
Yep, that's accurate. Of course, in all the romance parts, I knew the romance was going to be up your alley, because it's something you've said is one of your favorite types of romance, which is enemies to lovers, kind of.
Yeah, I like enemies to lovers when it's handled well.
But as much as I like James Easton, I also really want to punch him in the face. I just want to punch,
I mean, yeah, he's obnoxious.
That obnoxious little patriarchy twat in the face.
No, honestly, when he was like, the whole nurse horses versus soldiers argument, which go off, Mary, please. But around that point, I was like, no, this isn't enemies to lovers. This is jerk to lovers. I mean, it gets better, but I didn't end the book being like, I want you two together.
I mean, that particular situation hadn't hit enemies to lovers necessarily yet, because he's like, this is just the master of the house's lover that he's just having an affair with. There's no need to be polite to this little twat.
I don't know. I mean, like I said, they're not enemies. It felt more jerk to romance, which, like I said, he redeems himself a lot, especially later on. Especially with Mary being terrible about communication, and then him being like, like around there, he gains a little bit more sympathy. But like I said, I didn't end the book going, I want you two to be together. He was like, I'm moving to India. I'm like, cool, we can have a new romance. A better one.
No, we can't.
No, I don't want him back.
Oh, too bad.
He's okay. He's fine.
The author ships them. You will not escape.
I like him as a person. I just don't like him as a romantic partner to her.
Well, the author ships them. You cannot escape.
That would have been kind of cool, though, if we went to the next book and there was another love interest. Oh, well.
Well, then we'd be reading the Miss Fisher mysteries, which we should anyway, because they're set in the 20s and it's a fun mystery set.
It kind of worked out. It's like, hey, you're young. Keep shopping. You've definitely purchased one.
You also have to remember, he's only 20.
Only 20.
So, he's only 20.
I've read so many books around the same time period at this point. My brain is like, social customs from over 100 years ago. He's only 20.
He's only 20.
How could you get married at 20?
Because that was what was done.
I know. There were a couple parts where I was like, well, I'm only 20. I can't get married for like 5 more or something like that. It was a lot more years. And I was like, well, this is awkward. Honestly, okay, for his situation specifically, I don't get it. I get for most people, but he has a really good job already.
Yeah, and he wants to put more work in the job before he actually like settles down. And he sees having a wife as a business deal, and so doesn't want to cumber himself down with someone he has to take care of.
Which, granted, that whole business deal doesn't really last long, because if he's gonna be interested in Mary... No business deal from that. But, oh, shoot. I just realized we didn't talk about age and content warning. This is a YA.
It is a YA.
It's really good. The only content warning I could think of is death of a child. Other than that, there's no gore that I could think of.
No, not really.
And it's Victorian England, so we're not having innuendos or nothing. But yes, that was... all I wrote. Anyway, so back to what we were actually talking about. I am kind of glad we're going away from the Thorold house after this. They were really good for one book. Don't want to ever see them again. Any of them.
Oh, the Thorolds? Yeah. I would be fine with seeing the daughter again, just because I enjoy her character arc. Even if she was just maybe not as a character again, but maybe mentioned later in a later book as like, is an amazing pianist, such and such, you know?
I don't like her arc because it comes at the expense of Michael's.
I mean, not really, other than he got his heart broken.
Well, the whole, they don't ever confirm, but they imply very heavily, hey, he'll get out of jail because of your testimony, but still.
I mean, he would have gone to jail regardless.
No, he wouldn't. If he hadn't have fallen in love with Angelica, he wouldn't have come to work for her father.
Oh, no, you're right. That's fair. They may not have talked to marriage until after he started working with her father for an extended period of time, so it may still have been inevitable, just from a foolish kid following his love from Summer point of view.
I don't know. It sounded like she specifically picked him because he was poor. And it was like, hey, I'm going to piss off my parents.
Well, she did specifically pick him because he was poor, but nothing says that she picked him because he was poor that summer and not after he followed her and started working for her father.
Still.
Like, you were obviously very in love with me because you followed me all the way here. So I might as well, you know.
Still. It's not much of a redemption arc.
And he would have gone to jail even if she had stayed with him anyway, so...
Yeah, but the whole, I'll go with you to Venice, I will do whatever.
I'm not saying she's a good person.
Well, I'm just saying I don't like her. I don't like that her arc comes at the expense of his. So that's one of the reasons I'm like, cool, you're going to Venice. We will hopefully never see you ever again. And Mrs. Thorold's the villain. And then her husband...
is also kind of a villain.
He's just an idiot. Oh, that's another thing. I kept forgetting his name was Henry. Henry.
Henry Thurld.
I don't think they ever say Mrs. Thurld's name.
They don't, because she's just Mrs. Thurld. Because it's back when you took your husband's name and that's it. And then be polite. You don't use first names unless you're in intimate terms.
I do think that was a personal choice by the author to be like, see, she's completely overshadowed by her husband. She doesn't even get her own name.
Well, I mean, no one would use it because you would only ever use it if you were in intimate terms with her, which no one should be other than her husband at that age, or a close friend, which we never really see.
Yeah, but it just meant that because the reader never learns their first name. Let's see, I'm looking through to see if there were any.
We don't encounter a lot of older women in this book.
Martha Bridges, she was the widow, so we know her first name, but I guess she's technically widowed. Other than that,
she's the only older woman that we really have contact with.
Yeah, because there's Mrs. Lamond, who is James's housekeeper. But other than that, we actually don't meet that many characters.
No.
Especially that many female characters.
Yes.
Meet a lot of dudes, though.
We do meet a lot of dudes.
Yeah, no, that's basically it. And then, of course, we meet Anne and Felicity. Felicity's technically, not technically, she is married. So I guess she's the only married one we ever learned the first name of. Interesting. Mrs. Thurld was cool, though. I liked her as a villain.
Yes. Very evil.
I liked her plot.
My husband's breaking the law, so I'm going to break the law more.
Yeah, I just got to that part of the book, and I think I had an out-of-body experience, because I felt myself watching myself reading the part where it said, and she has a pirate crew.
Yep.
I was like, holy crap! That was never where my mind was going. She has a pirate crew that just robs her husband because, haha, hee-hee, hoo-hoo, stick it to the man.
She wanted to make her own money to have on the side, I guess, to be able to eventually support herself, maybe?
I don't know. It doesn't say.
And the easiest way to do that was to sink her husband's ships. Because she's making money doing what she does.
Yeah. Now that I realize, I don't think she ever says, and this is what my end goal is. She just wanted to stick it. Maybe she didn't have an end goal other than, haha, I have money. Screw you.
Maybe she didn't deem James worthy enough to let him in on the end goal.
I do appreciate that scene, though. Finally, a villain who seems like an actual person who's trying to kill you, not someone who just becomes super talkative because it's convenient for the main character.
Yeah, he had to force any of the answers out of her because she was just like, go, just shut up. I'm going to shoot you. No, really.
It made her even cooler because it was like, she knew what she was doing. She's ready. She's down. Let's go.
Yeah, and with as much as she managed to do, I doubt she didn't have an end goal. I just don't think she thought James worthy enough to know.
I don't know. She does come across pretty spiteful, so it could have even started as a...
It's just spite?
Yeah, it's just spite. Because she very specifically only goes for her husband's. And I mean, granted, yes, she has the best information about his ships, but I just like that she's like, no, only his ships.
I think he's also smuggling goods, though, too, so she knows that she can get better stuff off of his ships, for sure, off of than random other ships. Because since it's a pirate crew, it would just be random other ships.
True. I do like how the husband's plan is foiled by the wife because he was making all of these false claims to his insurance. And then he's having to make all of these real ones to the insurance, making him look even more suspicious.
No, really, they keep going down.
I swear.
I don't know why.
And then I love the twist of they don't believe a husband and wife are separate in the law. If a wife commits a crime, the husband is also part of it because clearly she's not competent enough to crime by herself. So that was really cool. Like it got turned on him.
Yeah.
You can't tell on me. I can just continue to rob you and there's nothing you can do about it.
Women run the world.
Once we got to the end, that made the one scene where he was like, hey, you guys should go to Brighton. And then she was like, no. And he was like, crap, I was hoping that would work. I guess that was where his mind was.
But the ocean, but your health, but please go to Brighton.
please stop robbing me. Please.
please stop robbing me.
Go on a vacation. You don't need to rob me for the summer. And then at the end where Michael was like, well, we can try to send them to Brighton. He was like, no, we can't.
Okay, so George Easton plays the accordion, right? This is completely off topic, but it just popped in my head. And a lot lot of people rag on the accordion like it's a bad instrument. And I'm like, have you ever heard accordion music, though? Because anything other than a polka sounds really nice on accordion. Accordion has some beautiful music. Accordion is a good instrument. Stop ragging on the accordion.
It's what people think of when they think of a lot of Italian cities or French.
It is. I would say it's better than the banjo.
Oh no, accordion versus banjo.
I mean, the history of the banjo is very interesting because it started in Africa, and there's actually a couple documentaries that document searching for the origin of the banjo, which is very interesting because it goes through a lot of different African instruments, which is a lot of fun. But I still think the accordion is better than the banjo.
George.
He plays some ballads. Nothing says he isn't good at accordion. They just rag on the accordion. I don't like George. I mean, I do like George and I don't like George at the same time, because George was soured for me when Mary was bumped into and spilt the pot of tea and it hit Angela's dress, and George was like, how could you?
Yeah.
George. But at the same time, the love-struck fool-esque character, feeling, aw, cutie. You poor honey.
Oh, I feel bad for James. I think that's another point where James becomes a little bit more sympathetic. He is basically running George's business because George is over there playing his accordion, being upset that Angelica won't marry him.
Hey, George, I know that you're like deeply, madly in love with this girl, but this is your business?
We're only making an underwater tunnel. Nothing serious or anything.
If you wouldn't mind assisting me in running it, that would be marvelous.
And then the fact that, I don't know why, I don't think it said why James decided he should go instead of George. But a part of me is like, is George just upset?
Probably.
He's heard the news Angelica's moving and he's just upset. His idea of, oh, in 2 weeks I can marry Angelica and take her to India and she'll be like, dude.
Get Angela to go to India. I dare you. Try it. She won't.
Like, even if you were married, I just don't see it happening. Like, she's very, very...
selfish?
That, yes. But I meant, like, comfortable where she was. And now she's, of course, going to Venice and facing things and stepping outside of her comfort zone.
Yes.
But if all that hadn't happened... Weirdly enough, though, I wouldn't mind George coming back as a character.
I think he does.
Because it's like you said, he's annoying, but also you can't hate him? I don't know. It's weird.
It's that sheer innocence.
I don't know if it's that for me as much as it is this. You're pathetic, dude. You're not a threat, I guess.
Yeah.
I'm like, you're fine. Whatever. Cassie was cool. I like Cassie's arc.
Yeah, Cassie's arc's good.
And I was really interested in the fact that she ran away because she thought Mary was part of the white slave traders.
I mean, there's a real danger of that. So, I mean, I get it.
But I did like that. I think that did add... There are a lot of... Not pop culture, because obviously it's not happening right now. But also, yes, on pop culture, there were a lot of pop culture conversations that I really liked. Things that were relevant at the time, like the conversation about Nurse Nightingale and her whole teaching nursing and that becoming a big thing. And, oh, it's a social topic. Women going to battlefields and stuff. And then that with the white slave trade being something whispered about and something they're concerned about. That was really cool. I feel like that's something a lot of books miss out on. These cultural events happening. That was really cool.
Right.
That's that PhD showing off. It's really cool.
Yeah. It also helps that she knows a lot about the time period. Not all authors do a huge amount of research into the time period they're writing in. And you don't necessarily need to, depending on the topic. But it's nice if you do, because then you can add little tidbits like this.
Yeah, it feels very authentic. Obviously... Jane Austen books aren't taken in the same time period, but it feels like that level of authentic minus the 100-year-old way of talking. So it was just really cool. It felt like a little slice of life thrown in there every once in a while.
Yes.
I'm really interested in learning more about Felicity's relationship with her husband.
I think they are no longer together.
Oh, that's surprising.
I got that vibe very strongly that they were no longer together.
I don't know. I got that vibe either he doesn't pay attention to her like Mrs. Thorold, and that's why she can do all of this stuff, or he was a bad B feminist before they existed, but...
No, they're not together. It's no longer a thing.
That was the thing. It was just not much about him.
It definitely got out of a bad marriage vibe, like a potentially killed her husband vibe.
But then she would have to wear all black.
Not necessarily. You only have to do that for a certain period of time. Did you also get the vibe that Felicity and Anne were a couple?
No.
I did. They seem very coupley.
To me, it always felt best friendy, only because this book has no sexual tension ever. It's very chaste.
Yes.
So I couldn't really anything with that.
I was listening to the audiobook though, and it may just have been the way that the author was reading it, but they felt very much like a couple.
I don't know.
Like it felt more like a step beyond best friendy, you know, like the lean closer together-esque thing and the cute little in-jokes and pet names and...
I don't know. I feel like it's harder with women because they're allowed so much more leeway on affection and socially acceptable. I feel like that's always harder to call out. That's one thing we can look in the other books, but they don't spend enough time because we're too busy grilling Mary. You gotta know the things. I really like Anne, though.
She's a good character.
I like that she kidnaps. Well, she doesn't kidnap because it's by consent, but smuggles girls out of prison, potentially.
That was not consensual. They chloroformed her and she woke up in a different place. That was kidnap.
Okay, that's true. I forgot that part. So they do kidnap.
It became consensual, but it started out as kidnap.
That was fun. That is how you use a prologue. Oh my goodness. For the first time ever, I read a prologue and I was like, yes, that is a prologue.
Amazing.
That was good. I honestly can't think of any other book where it's like prologue, where it's like, that should have been the first chapter. But like that made sense. Kidnapping her to become part of the thing. And then the actual book is about her becoming part of the agency. That made sense. Let's go. I'm down. I liked how much they talked about how bad the Thames smells.
Thames?
Because yes. I'm just glad somebody is like, hey, this smells really bad. Yes, it smells really bad.
Yeah, and they talk about why it smells bad and what potentially needs to happen to be able to fix it. But essentially, all the sewer lines run into the river and there's a bunch of factories that dump their waste into the river and animals are just dying in the river. And then it gets heated up in the summer. And so all of that is cooking. And so the only way to really start to fix that ish is to not let people dump waste in the river and to reroute the sewage lines and all that fun stuff. But it's disgusting.
And they used the word miasma and I was like, ooh, that's a good word. That was really cool.
They made it sound like it was a jello-like sludge instead of a river.
Yeah, it just sounded so unpleasant, which it was. So, skipping to the very beginning when we first meet Mr. James Easton, I thought James was the suitor that Angelica's mom wanted her to marry. And I was like, oh my gosh, that's so spicy. But then I found out about George, and I don't know whether it would have been not necessarily better if James was the one Angelica was going after, but it would have been spicy.
I mean, Angelica would rather have had James than George, but her mom wanted her to marry George because George is the first son, and heaven forbid you marry a second son because all of the inheritance from the family goes to the first.
Yeah, and supposedly George is more settled, even though James is doing all of his work and is a partner at the firm, but okay.
Well, I mean, George started the firm. Now he's courting Angela.
It's a job.
You've met Angela. Courting Angela is a job.
Ugh, sorry. But I don't want to court Angela. She was mean.
Yeah, I liked her as a minor villain character.
She goes from sympathetic to hellspawn so many times in the book.
Yeah, I like her.
It's like as soon as I'm starting to be like, oh, I feel you, Angelica, she's like, digs her nails into a burn. It's like, hey, cool, go get arrested. I'm gonna go live somewhere else. Like, I just, there are themes. Like, I swear, as soon as she becomes sympathetic, she's like, immediately was like, nah, let me just throw this in there.
Yeah, she's a selfish, I like her. I wouldn't want to be friends with her, but she makes a nice minor villain. It's like in Batman, she's like the Riddler, the kind of side, the side bad guy that everybody makes fun of because he does riddles.
I love the Riddler. He's so campy.
Yeah, that's what I'm saying.
It's a fun time, though.
Yeah, but everybody makes fun of him because he's a side villain character.
Also, he appeared in one of those, what was it, 80s Batman movies?
Yeah.
That doesn't help. Honestly, she makes me think of Two-Face more than anything else.
Yeah, kind of. Just still kind of like a side villain character. Yeah, but I mean, she's a side villain character. The Riddle is just the first one I thought of.
James's shock of her dressing up like a boy. Sorry, it always makes me laugh whenever we read a book of this time period. And it's like, she's wearing pants! I have so many notes. Sorry, we're going past the Michael thing again. Ugh. I don't know. Part of me is like, it would have been cute if they did stay together and he went to Venice and worked while she worked on becoming a famous pianist. But oh well. Alas.
I don't think they would have stayed together regardless because she didn't really love him.
Well, that was, it was more of a... if
I know. It's like a partnership marriage. Like he works and helps support her while she works on music.
Yeah. Because a lot of those marriages were financial partnerships more than anything else. And it's like, that would have been good.
But I feel like he would have made made her start a family, and she didn't want that.
Yeah. I don't know if it's necessarily make as much as a social custom. Like, that's what you do when you get married.
Yeah. I feel like he would have pressured her into it, and she would have been unhappy with the decision.
Yeah. She doesn't need to be a mom.
No. This is before you could choose to not be a mom.
Yeah. You had very limited options otherwise.
Yes.
I feel like she would turn out exactly like her mom. Maybe not as smart as her, because Mrs. Thorold is wickedly intelligent.
Literally.
But I totally see her doing things despite her husband, just because. And then using her daughter as chips, just like her mom's using her.
Yeah. I mean, that's the time period that's part of the reason you had kids, was to use them to further the family name.
She was so excited to disinherit Angelica. I could tell she was like at her wit's end with her. She's like, you're just a selfish brat. And as soon as I can, I'm going to be done with you. Whether you get married off or I disinherit you, I don't care. No love.
Which is interesting, because Angela seemed to genuinely care for her mom, because the only time she ever got kind and quiet was when her mom was having a quote-unquote health issue-esque thing.
Yeah.
Seemed very particularly sickly. So that was an interesting dynamic.
She also had weird favoritism toward her father, and we don't really play with that dynamic as much.
I don't think it was favoritism as much as putting on a front in front of the man that could literally ruin her life if he got it in his head that she had not been brought up correctly.
Yeah. Well, that's what I mean. It's like, I can't get a read on it as much. I'd like to know a little bit more about them, but we don't have as much time.
No, you don't. You don't want to read more about them.
Honestly, I was kind of surprised how little Thorold is in the book. He is the main suspect the entire time, and we barely see him. I think we see the footman almost as much as we see him.
William? Yeah.
And he and the cook just need to... No, guys, stop. But I think I really like, from the beginning of the book, I could tell that she was Asian, or at least a part Asian. Just the way that they described her and stuff, it was being very specific about how she had black hair and her eye shape and color and things like that. But I do think it's really interesting that she is half Asian, half Irish. And then there's this huge part in the book of her coming to accept herself, but also what that would mean for her socially to be half Chinese.
I don't think she's actually accepted herself yet.
She hasn't.
She's just coming more to terms with it.
Yeah. She can at least admit it to herself at some point. But as soon as she admits it to herself, it becomes a really fearful thing that other people are going to figure it out and then think less of her, which is lame. But another social topic.
I mean, and they will. They will 100% think less of her, because in this time period, Chinese were not even human to whites, because white supremacy is at its utmost.
And yet another pop culture thing just to throw in there to be like, hey, Chinese sailors were treated terribly. It was better to be considered Irish than Chinese, which is saying something during that time period, because the Irish were still not on equals footing.
Yes.
We're past the part where we can write satire about how the Irish shouldn't eat their children, but we're not quite to freedom. So somewhere in between there.
Yeah.
But I thought that was really interesting. That was a really unique dynamic that a lot of books don't have. So that was an added letter. What was in the box? I knew as soon as she left the box with Mr. Chin, I was like, you're not going to get the box. That necklace is going to be all you have. And then in the end, when the fire happens and... What was in the box?
I feel like it might come up again, but it's been years since I've read the second book, so I cannot guarantee anything.
Yeah, a part of me wondered, because she doesn't necessarily have the chance to actually look and be like, oh, it was burned or it wasn't burned, but she does not end this book seeing the box.
Yes.
All she has is that jade necklace.
Yes.
And she read that really short thing that her dad wrote to her, but she didn't get to read what he wrote to her mom.
Or look at the documents that he left, yeah.
Which was so sad.
Maybe he's on a pirate crew now.
That would be the plot twist.
Maybe for whatever reason they didn't kill him and they just brought him onto the pirate crew.
Because they totally say in the book how sometimes the pirates will recruit.
Maybe he's live. That's the pirate.
The sailors. And so, yeah, he's a pirate. Comes back. It would be a series logic, the third book.
Yep.
Where he pops up and he's a pirate.
I mean, that's the one I haven't read. So, yeah, being the one.
Perfect. all the people who started with the third book, what is happening?
Why would you start with a third book? Why would you start with a second book?
I don't understand. There are some people that do that.
Pick up the first one. Read the first one. You get all the context in the first one.
I've met people who just want to read the newest book. And so if the newest book is number 6 in the series, they get mad when they don't understand the context. And it's dumb.
It's like, yeah, you don't understand it because you're in book 6. It's like if I were to pick up book 7 from Harry Potter, you'd be so confused. What is going on? What are Dementors? What giant spiders? Who is Voldemort? I don't understand what's happening.
Why isn't every piece of medium created so I can just pick it up and put it down like it's a 90s sitcom? What? I should be able to come in episode 100 and totally understand. Yeah, it's dumb. I hate it. That logic always messes with me. I'm like, just read the first one.
You have to start at book 1. Sorry to inform you of this. The reason you don't like books is because you don't start at book 1. Also, the reason you might not like books is because you were forced to read books in school, and so you haven't read anything for your own pleasure in years. And so maybe start with a YA novel because they don't have complex emotions, because adult books have complex emotions. These are relatively easy to understand emotions, and they're easier to grasp, so that you can just follow along with the story and be swept away. They're much more fun.
But then you might have to deal with teenagers.
Depends on which YA novel book you're reading. So if you picked up one like this, or you were to pick up a good YA novel book.
Yeah, but I'm just saying, I don't trust people that don't read books to just magically pick up good ones.
Somewhere between adult books and YA books, you know, like somewhere in between these. Pick up maybe one of the YA books that we've read that we think is good. If you're listening to this and you don't read books.
Sorry, now I'm thinking of all the YA novels that I picked up randomly. Most of them were vampire, but that's just the time period we were in.
Yeah.
So much paranormal.
Yeah, I read a lot of vampire books back in middle school as well. So apparently I read different ones than you.
That's the amazing thing about that time period is we both read books, but there were enough paranormal YA that we read a lot of paranormal YA, but not the same paranormal YA.
Yeah, we read a lot of books of the same genres, but different books in the same genres.
Paranormal YA, we're very off topic.
We are very off topic. So at the beginning, right, where they say you will be hung by the neck until death. And I'm like, is anybody ever hung to the neck until discomfort or hung to the neck until you pass out and then you let down?
Yeah.
Well, no. I mean, like on purpose.
Oh, no. No, that's a bad idea.
Not by accident. On purpose. Like you're sentenced to hung by the neck until discomfort.
No. The hope is that when it happens, it'll break the hyoid bone. And then you'll suffocate quickly.
Yeah.
It does not always do that.
No.
It's actually a very gruesome way.
No, there's a bunch of horror stories out there of people that were about to be buried and were actually alive or woke up in a body pile after being hung, you know, all that sorts of fun stuff.
Yeah. On a really random note that I just have here, do people really hiccup after crying? She did that so many times in this book where she would just like be to tears and then at the end she would be hiccuping. I'm like, I have never hiccuped after crying. Mary, do people hiccup after crying?
I mean,
is that a thing?
I'm not a very vocal crier, but I guess maybe if you were to like be a vocal crier, maybe. I don't know.
I don't know. That was something that just never occurred to me as happening. But yeah, it just kept popping up.
Maybe she was hyperventilating while she was crying and it set off the hiccups. Sometimes that'll happen.
That was just a really random thought.
Sometimes laughing will set hiccuping off, so maybe if you're using your lungs incorrectly while crying, it'll set off hiccups. I apparently don't do that. I cry the right way. Alone, under a blanket.
Superior crying skills. I like that the boy was the damsel in the distress. Ha ha ha. I feel like so many, like it could have been like such an easy thing to be like, oh, Mary, you're the damsel in distress because you've gotten too into this and James has to come save you. No! No, 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 no. James is the damsel in distress. Mary has to come save him. And Mary follows up on a very, very, very vague clue and thankfully comes to your rescue. Except the house wouldn't have burned down anyway, apparently.
Yeah, but the upper floor still would have been not, because that's where it started. So it still wouldn't have been great.
Yeah.
She saved you from potential nasty burns.
It got to that part, it was like, oh yeah, it wouldn't have burned down. Well, I do like the part where it's like, yeah, if it would have burned down, you guys would have been dead. I was like, thank you. Why are you kissing on the landing? Why? Guys, priorities?
No, never.
And then they get outside and the crowd's gone and they're like, oh yeah, it's too wet here. See, it's almost put itself out.
Yeah, the building's full of mildew. We've mentioned this several times. The building's very moist.
It was like, well, that's anticlimactic. But like I said, that was also my favorite part.
Where'd the crowd go? Well, the building wasn't actually going to burn down, so they all left because all they wanted was to see it burn. It's like the people that show up for hangings.
I think that was one of my favorite parts in the book, was the whole guys kissing, not now, and then getting outside and being like, oh, we did it. We finally made it. Oh my goodness. What do you mean it wasn't going to burn down? That was funny. I don't know if she meant for it to be funny, but I found that really funny. I have a very strange sense of humor.
Yes, that's okay. We still love you. Yeah, that's fairly well written.
He's good. 1850s, man.
Enjoyed. And yeah, it was good. It's a good book.
I am sad that there's only four of them.
Yep, I've only read the first two.
I don't know if it was chosen. Like, she knew it was going to be the end and there's like a written end, or if it kind of leaves it open. Like, there could have been a fifth book, but...
we'll find out. Sometimes I'm kind of glad when there's only like three or four, because then they don't have time to second guess themselves later on and be like, well, the fans want this, and make the characters do things that they wouldn't necessarily do, or the plot goes somewhere where it wasn't led to believe that it was gonna go. Because I've read so many series where you get to like book five and you're like, why all of a sudden is this character gone and that one dressing in hot pink when she only wore black two books ago?
Yeah,
what is happening?
Yeah. You don't live long enough to see yourself become the villain kind of thing.
Yes. Yeah. Or like the Sherlock series on TV, you know, where it slowly gets weirder and weirder and weirder. And all of a sudden, I don't really know what's going on, but apparently this villain is back. And so...
There was an author I was following on Twitter, and she made a really funny point. She was writing this book in the series and thinking of this great plot point just to realize that I killed the character in the last book.
Oh, no.
That kind of thing.
Don't be the sort of author that pretend brings them back just for a plot point. Is kind of what I'm getting at. But yeah, that's a good... That's really sad. Like, oh no.
Dang it.
She could write her own fan art for if the character hadn't died. It's like a little soap paperback as a, if I didn't kill this character.
Can authors write fan fiction about their own stuff?
I don't see why not. Because I mean, it's not canon, because it's not, that character's dead. So it wouldn't be part of the, I mean, it would probably be its own. I don't necessarily think you'd call it fan fiction, but it's not.
Alternate universe.
Yeah, let's.
We're getting into Marvel.
Yeah, we are. Yep.
So I was just checking out her website to see if there was anything else. It makes it sound like she purposely ended it at four. It's like, that is the final one. Because I've seen some authors' websites and it was like, we've written this book and now writing the sequel. And it'll be copyrighted or dated 2011. And you're just like,
Like, how's that sequel coming? You doing good? You still, no? All right. It happens. This life.
Yeah. It gets a little sad and you're like, oh. Never mind. She's written a lot of short stories about the time period too, so that's pretty cool.
That's cool.
Yeah, she's written a ton of short stories and stuff. She's just cool. Y.S. Lee. She awesome. I love her.
So she is.
She knows her stuff. She knows how to write a pretty good book.
It's dope, y'all.
It's dope. Please read. Honestly, if you'd like mystery or romance, this is a pretty good read because it's both. I think I've decided on Misty Ants for mystery romance. Misty Ants. You got some mist and some ants. That is what I'm calling this genre now. You're welcome.
Misty Ants. Yeah.
Because that sounds so much better than roistery.
Romery?
Roasty? Roastery?
Roistery? It's roasty.
All these just sound terrible. I'm sticking with Misty Ants.
They're roasty, misty ants.
Let's see. One question for the author. So my question isn't book related, but I'm curious how she just found her passion in Victorian era stuff. Because you don't go on to get a PhD in something without having a dedicated love.
Yep.
I'm just curious how that came to be. Because my husband also really likes Victorian literature. And he found that passion a little bit happenstance. He's read a bunch of eras and that's just his favorite. So that's how he's found his kind of passion for it. So I'm curious. I wonder how she found her passion for the Victorian era. I'm pretty sure she's Canadian. So that'd be really cool now.
I want to know who she based her characters off of. Like who she knows personally that she based her characters off of. Where did you get the idea for the personalities that work on these characters? That are these characters?
That does lead. I wonder if she created the personalities first or she created the plot and then made personalities as she felt they were needed.
Yeah.
I'm always curious about that.
Be fun to know.
Rating. Women need more spy media. media directed toward them out of 10. Screw James Bond, this is cooler.
Yeah, there's some good feminists in this book. My rating is, you know when you're playing Skyrim and you don't think your sneak is necessarily high enough to be doing a sneak mission and you're sitting in a shadow and a guard walks right past you and you're just sitting there dead still like, don't see me, don't see me, don't see me, don't see me, and they don't, that feeling out of 10.
Don't see me, don't see me, don't see me,
don't see me, don't see me, don't see me, don't see me. Oh, thank goodness. I didn't. Partly because that always makes me feel really giddy. I'm like, oh, I did it. I don't have to start over and try again.
To go with that, when it's like a little eyeball, instead of it being all the way open, you're like, no, 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 don't see me, don't see me, don't see me, don't see me. And then you get in the shadow and it closes and you're like, oh my gosh.
Do you know how much more nerve-wracking that is in VR?
Oh my gosh, I would hate that.
Because the headset has a mic, so sometimes if you're sneaking, if you say something out loud, because I talk to myself while I'm playing video games, if I say something out loud, the guard's like, what? And I'm like, oh no! It picked me up, no!
Oh no, no, no. But would you read it again? Yes.
Yep, definitely.
Yeah, that was fun time. It was a roller coaster. It was actually very exciting.
Yes, it's a good book.
I really like how she manages to keep it interesting and heart pumping, but also still have the formalness of the Victorian era, because some books don't actually walk that very well and it's kind of stuffy, but she does a really good job and it doesn't feel like cumbersome at all, which is cool.
Yes, I agree.
It's a fun time. If you like Victorian era, if you like romance, if you like mystery, any of those, it's a good book. I don't know which playlist to put it in. I might put it in both, or I'll create Misty Ants and only have this book in it. But have you read this book? Do you ship Mary and James? Do you have any book recommendations for us? Tell us all about it in the comments below. If you like this video, hit like, and if you are enjoying yourself, hit subscribe for more fun book content.
Thanks for exploring A Spy in the House with us.
You can keep up to date with us by checking us out on Twitter, Instagram, or TikTok, and you can help support our podcast by checking us out on Patreon, where for just $1 a month, you can get access to our bonus episodes, where we look at movie adaptations to some of your favorite books. This month, we're continuing our Harry Potter series as we look at Harry Potter and the Goblet of Fire.
Join us next time when we'll be reading The Cat Who Could Turn On and Off, written by Lillian Jackson Braun.
Thank you so much for hanging out with us today. I'm Sam Reiner.
And I'm Lizzie Sawyer.
And we hope to see you and a friend here next time.